parking and everything, huh?
I walked like that over my head. It's just not happening.
Okay.
I can just take my hair to this. It was so nice yesterday.
And I know you're going to be the absolute best listeners and respectful of our guest speaker, right?
Greatest,
you're gonna. Matt's gonna walk away from the school and say that Cascadia College has some awesome students.
You at least think we're clever at the end.
We're a group. We're a bunch.
All right. But you gotta have fun too.
Yeah.
But respectful. All right, thank you, and I give you Matt ready.
All right.
Let's give a little however you welcome somebody.
That was a very nice welcome. I'm going to tell you guys a little bit of my story today. But I want to get some idea of who's in the room here. So I got two questions for you guys. We'll start with a simple one. Who here considers himself an activist? You want to raise your hand if you consider yourself an activist.
And in our language, it's called, remember we saw that videotape, it's not just like a non-racist. It's anti-racism, actually does something.
Are you referring to, you said racism?
Well, we saw a little clip about what's the difference between being a non and being anti. And anti is equivalent in the video to actually doing something, not just saying, I'm not this, I'm not this.
Okay. All right, so again, hands up high if you consider yourself an activist. I mean, it makes sense. Okay? All right. And now, who here has a really good answer for the question, why are you here? Why are you here in this room today? Yeah?
To eventually be in a position where I can make money, or a substantial amount of money.
Okay, great.
To learn something new.
All right.
To solve points, bring down false arguments about preconceived notions that people have about certain things.
What's that?
To help bring down preconceived notions about certain things.
Yeah.
There's specific subjects here?
Mainly right now what is going on is politics, religion, and race complex.
Nice. All right, who else? A couple more answers. We got a sense. Anyone else? Why are you here? So, I've learned over my years of, the last 10 years, that's a really big question. You need to know why you are where you are. Why your body is where it is. If you ever become an activist or participate in activism, it's really important to know why you're standing where you're standing, because sometimes you're putting yourself in harm's way. So you sort of learn. You always know why you're there, and if you don't have a reason to be somewhere, you just leave. And when I talk to groups, I do it in a format called an open space. Anyone ever participated in an open space gathering? Anyone know what an open space is?
No.
Okay, an open space, you would get a bunch of people together like this, and you would say, whoever wants to suggest a topic to talk about, you write it, and you say you write it up here. You may have 10 topics, and then everyone sort of gets a spot, and you just go to the one you want to go to. And you don't have to stay there. You can go and listen, or you can leave it, go to another one. It's really freedom of movement. And that's what I'm most comfortable with. Because I don't like, it feels kind of oppressive to me to be sort of forced to sit and listen to someone for 2 hours. But, you know, I never do this, and so this is kind of fun. You're like a captive audience for me. Alright, so we're going to get into it. My story, my goals, my tactics, my current work. You're going to learn a lot about me today. I grew up in Maryland. Obviously, I'm a member of the privileged class. You know, white mainstream America. I studied philosophy in school. This is my mom. She died of cancer about 10 years ago. I was a big artist in school. When I got into college, I studied Thoreau. Anyone ever read Thoreau? Walden? It's good stuff. I love Thoreau. He's got this great attitude, very much like I said about, you know, life. You know, he's like, know what you're doing and why you're doing it. believed in simplicity, and he believed in just sort of seeking your path, you know, not doing what everyone around you tells you to do. And that's something that has been very central to me all my life. After college, I went to a place called Twin Oaks. It's actually a commune in Virginia. It's been around for like 30 or 40 years, where they try to make a truly socialist communal society. All work is equal there. Doesn't matter if it's taking care of the kids or doing dishes or making money. They just count work as an hour of labor, and the most egalitarian place I've ever seen. But they do a lot of work there. I didn't, for me, it was too much. They do 40 hours of work a week, and I know that sounds like mainstream, but Thoreau said you could like live off of 4 hours a day of work, and I was like, I like that. 4 hours a day of work, and then I can go and do art and write and explore life. Anyone like that idea? 4 hours a day of work? Yeah. Sounds pretty good, yeah. Oh, and by the way, anytime, if you want to just raise your hand and ask me a question, feel free, okay? Yeah?
You said egalitarian?
Egalitarian? So it just means equal. Just means equal. So as equal as possible. So right now, this is not an equal power dynamic in this room, because I have the power, I'm the speaker, I have sort of. But if this was egalitarian, we'd have to agree who's going to speak, and how are we going to decide who gets to speak. And one solution for that is like a talking stick or a talking rock. Anyone ever use that in a group? Yeah. Your hand around? Yeah, that's it's an egalitarian solution, unless you start fighting over the rock or the stick. That's a power struggle. Okay, so I moved to Port Townsend, Washington. I don't know, Lincoln Peninsula. Anyone ever been there? No? It's a cool little town, cool community. I was just going to live a simple life, do art, get whatever job, you know, could make me enough money to live. And I just sort of, I was enjoying my life there. Y2K happened. That was the year 2000 computer glitch thing. At the same time, I was getting into the big internet explosion. And started getting really fired up about the potential of the internet to change the world. I did some movie making. I became a mini activist with Y2K, trying to get the community prepared for. Some people were worried that the power grid was going to collapse due to computer malfunctions. Anyone ever hear that during the Y2K? Yeah. So, you know, I researched it and thought, you know, there is a chance there could be some bad stuff happening. So I did some Y2K activism. And that actually took me into a career at this hospital, Jefferson Healthcare, public hospital. And then I also got married and adopted 5 kids.
Oh, wow.
Dang,
that escalated quickly.
Yeah.
Do you have any biological kids?
So one of my first attempts to change the world was called the Wisdom Project. This idea of, again, inspired by the internet, how to extract the wisdom from masses of people. Because I felt that's what the world needed, wisdom. And that was fun. It sort of lasted a while, and then it sort of went away. Another thing I tried was called Vistro. And it was about trying to, again, do something with masses of people, but this time using their voices, sort of a voice blog platform, using your iPhones. You could go and ask a question. People could answer the questions. You could rate the answers, and then the best questions would bubble up to the top, sort of works on a lot of forums. Reddit. People use Reddit in here? Raise your hand if you've used Reddit before. No, or Dig. Anyone know what Dig is? No, it's an old one. Back in the internet early years. Okay, so Vistro failed. That marriage ended. Met a new awesome lady named Stacy. And my life hit a crisis point where I was like, what the heck am I doing with my life? And I turned to meditation, which is a practice that I've used throughout my life. And it's always been sort of a rock of a practice to go back to help me sort of figure out where I am. Who here has ever meditated? Just raise your hand. So for those of you that don't know, never done it, meditation basically just means you stop and you be still. creates awkwardness. I mean, in a group like this, it creates awkward silence. But it also creates awkward silence when you do it by yourself. So then you're just sitting there. The only thing making noise is that voice in your head. And then you have to like listen to it or decide what you're going to do with it. It's very powerful to sit for any amount, 10 minutes. It's powerful if you've never done it before. Just sitting still. Yeah.
You do it like maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, the best, if you want to try meditation, I'm putting out a book about it, but it's basically just sitting still. There's lots of different styles. And do it 5 minutes in the morning and just see what it does. If you really want to get a taste of it, 20 minutes is the way to go. 20 minutes in the morning.
Do you do any specific meditation, or is it just, like you said, the general meditation of being quiet and thinking?
Meditation is like dancing. Right? And so in dancing, there's really structured forms and there's very loosey-goosey forms, you know, where you do whatever you want. I prefer the loosey-goosey forms of meditation where you can do whatever you want. But there's a lot to learn from being completely still, because you can kind of like entertain yourself if you start walking and distracting yourself. And it gives you something, it might let you ignore some of the things your mind is telling you to listen to. So it's a good exercise to be completely still. And then another practice that I really respect is journaling after you meditate. So journal 10 minutes, then just meditate whatever 10 minutes, then journal, and just write down whatever you remember from your meditation sit. That's what I recommend. And then you can journal about other stuff too. Anyways, I could talk for 2 hours about meditation, but that's not what we're gonna do today. But one thing that happened while I was meditating was the Occupy movement, the U.S. Occupy Wall Street movement, was exploding. Everyone heard of that? Raise your hand if you've heard of the Occupy. Some of you have not heard of it. This is a fascinating world. So Occupy was a global movement that erupted in the U.S. out of Zuccotti Park, I believe in 2011. The Zuccotti Park in New York. It was actually inspired by the Arab Spring. Who here has heard of the Arab Spring? So there's lots of interesting stuff you're going to learn today. Interesting to me, which is good since I'm a speaker. So Occupy was sweeping the U.S. and people, activists, were coming out of the woodworks and they were talking about the 99%, how 1% of the people in this country own something like 90% of the wealth in this country. You guys heard that before? Aware of that? It's a massive imbalance of wealth distribution in our country. On top of that, money controls our democracy. Anyone disagree with that? That money controls our democracy, decides who gets elected, decides our elections. If anyone wants to challenge me, I'd love to argue with you about that. Okay.
Maybe later.
Okay.
Tough argument.
Yeah.
So people were coming, and I was sick and frustrated with this myself, but I didn't think anyone else cared. So when people started taking to the streets, and this is exactly what they were saying, this was the critique they were saying, money is controlling our country. It's very much like Bernie Sanders.
Bernie's a man.
Well, Occupy paved the way in this country for Bernie Sanders to be able to talk like he talked. He was talking the language that the Occupy movement brought into the mainstream. Yeah. So I was inspired by this, and I was like, I want to get involved with Occupy. So I went to Seattle and found the Occupy Seattle group, went to one of their general assemblies, talked to the people helping to organize it, and I had to decide if I wanted to help organize or join Occupy Seattle or go somewhere or try to do something in Port Townsend where I lived. And so this was a tactical decision, and that's what all of activism is. If you want something to change, you're always making decisions what action to take. And so that was the first action tactical decision of my activist journey. And I chose to focus on Port Townsend and try to get things going there. I learned a lot about egalitarian facilitation, which again is just about how do you work with a group and have completely equal power. Because most groups, most ways societies around the world work is they create hierarchy. You know, know, most, that's just the easiest, simplest way to make a group function. You create a hierarchy, say someone is the leader. But that's another massive innovation in the Occupy movement. It was trying to be egalitarian. It was trying to be a leaderless movement, which was required really skilled facilitation. And I'm a group facilitator, so I studied that and learned how to do it. So I just walked up to the Occupy Port Townsend group that was just sort of a Sunday 2-hour protest, and I just said, hey guys, you wanna do something bigger? Wanna maybe get a General Assembly going, a bigger, and sort of expand our numbers and see if we could do stuff? And people were receptive, and we got things going. And a lot of things happened. We had a massive, and I'll probably show some, there'll be some pictures of it later. I think a picture would be more fun. This is a picture of the first Occupy Port Townsend General Assembly. It's one of the oldest, it is the oldest county in Washington State. So it's an interesting demographic of people to try to stir up and to try to mobilize. But things happen. We had a lot of, let's see, we have some pictures. This is me. We did a lot of Bank of America protests because Bank of America was kind of a symbol of corporate power. Yeah?
I'm actually doing my project on economic inequality. And I looked into like problems. And I was wondering, like, what were you guys' like solutions for like solving the problem?
Solutions. Let's come back to that.
Okay.
I'm also going to follow up on that question too.
Yeah.
Later on. Yeah. I want to see if you mentioned
it. Sure. Oh, we'll get to my ideas for solutions. So this was at Bank of America. This was me going to the Occupy National Gathering in Philadelphia, marching with some pretty crazy activists, amazing activists there. This was from the day that we basically shut down Bank of America. We did a march and set this giant tent right in front of the front door so people couldn't really get in. Then people went around and blocked the drive-through. And that's me sitting in the tent with a couple of my friends, fellow activists. This is people laying down in the drive-through. That's me. We had music blasting. They put caution tape to block the driveway. We fully expected to get arrested that day, so we were just sitting there waiting. But the police came, and we have a very liberal police force, and they decided, go ahead, shut it down for the day, and they didn't arrest anybody. And so we were all kind of shocked, but stirred people up. Bank of America then hired 2 full-time security guards. So we did some economic improvement in the town. We created 2 full-time jobs with the security guards. This is also at the Occupy National Gathering. This is me right there, sitting there. And this was chaos. There was not good facilitation. And this was a group surrounded by militarized police and park police. I ended up facilitating at the 3rd Occupy National Gathering, participated in tons of marches, witnessed many interesting police confrontations, witnessed violence. And at many of these, my goal at going to these big gatherings was trying to network and trying to figure out how this national Occupy movement could make a difference, could actually solve some of these problems. And so I wanted to talk about tactics. I wanted to talk about what are we doing, why are we doing it, and how are we doing it. And there were other people that wanted to, but not a lot. And, you know, looking back, maybe I didn't try hard enough. Maybe I should have pushed harder. But I think I was personally always afraid of sort of stepping up to be a leader-ish position. And when you did the Occupy movement, it was really apparent, especially when you went to the national gatherings. It was a group very sensitive to power and to privilege and to whether, and so a white male was in a tricky spot. I did not want to be part of the problem. And so it held me back some. This would be facilitating at the Occupy, third Occupy. This is a gathering in Olympia, interesting Occupy event. That's when we occupied the courthouse in Fort Townsend. We did that one night. Okay, so the Occupy movement stops. It basically stops because the police raid all the Occupy camps and shut them down. And then, for whatever reason, it sort of fizzles and evolves. And I think what basically happened is people started going into politics and being candidates and spreading in different ways. I don't know. That's another whole topic. So I kind of go back to my life. Like, that was a great burst of activism. I go sort of back to living my life. I'm working at the hospital this whole time. And then I have a good friend who has a very incredibly painful medical condition. And I'm seeing my friend suffering, and I'm saying, you know, I work at the hospital. I'm saying, look, why don't you go to the hospital? You know, why don't you go to the doctor? And she says, no, because she's sick of paying off medical bills. She doesn't want to go because she knows they're going to want an MRI or something. It's going to cost $2,000. She's going to owe at least $1,000 of that, and she's just sick of it, so she'd rather suffer. And so I'm just watching my friend, like, basically cry in pain. She's suffering so much. And again, I go into problem-solving mode. What do? I want to solve this problem. And I struggle with it. I go to the hospital. I talk to the different departments. I try to see what they can do for her. There's no real solution. Healthcare, this started to open my eyes to how big of a mess healthcare is in this country. We have the most dysfunctional healthcare system in industrialized nations in the world. Because we have this octopus of a multi-payer healthcare system, as opposed to a universal healthcare system like smart countries have. So, I start thinking about this. So my activist sort of energy starts thinking about this in healthcare and in my workplace. I think it's absurd that this hospital that I've worked at for like 14 years is not caring for people in our community that need it. And I'm like, there has to be, even though we don't have universal healthcare in this country, maybe we could do something in our county just to at least make sure people in our county could get care. You know, it doesn't sound like that difficult a problem, right? It's like, I'm like, fine, let the rest of the country suffer, but let's do something in our city or our county. So, I started doing research. What are other cities, counties, and hospital districts in the country doing? I figure I can't be the first one that looked at suffering in a community due to healthcare and said we could actually solve this on a local scale, and I was right. There were other places that tried to do this. The most impressive one was San Francisco. Did something called Healthy San Francisco. And that was basically one leader, Gavin Newsom, who was mayor at the time of San Francisco. He got elected and he said, let's solve healthcare for the people of San Francisco. And when he got into office, he just said, he said to his minions, you know, he said, gather leaders of hospitals and of city governments, business leaders, you know, all the power people in the city, create a committee, and their task is to come up with a solution so that everyone in San Francisco can get health care. And he gave them like 3 months to work on it. And so he didn't have to have the solution. He just had to say, this is the problem, state the problem, and you say, let's solve it. And you say, try to solve it. And they came up with this Healthy San Francisco program, and it works really well. I actually have a friend living in San Francisco who said he was helped by it incredibly. Gavin Newsom is a very cool, I don't know, can I swear in here? He's very, he's sort of a badass in terms of like politicians. He was also the guy that he kind of really kickstarted the same-sex marriage sort of revolution that sort of swept the country. That was many years ago, he just one day said, you know what, we're just going to start accepting gay marriage certificates in San Francisco. And just like, it was absolutely cutting edge, and it blew up across the country, and it, a lot of same-sex marriage activists actually thought it was a bad idea. Didn't think our country was ready for it. But you know, it's like pushing the envelope in different areas sort of helps stir up the energy in other people. So anyways, back to what the heck I was gonna do in for my friend in my county. How could I make this happen? And again, I was sitting there like, what could I do? Any ideas? I was working at the hospital, I'd study this. Anyone have any guess what I did or any even things I considered? Yeah, got one?
Did you try talking to the director of the hospital?
Good, talking to people in the hospital. Any other ideas of what I could try?
Fundraiser,
try to just make money to help pay for, create a fund or something?
Yeah.
Help. Good, any other ideas?
Petition?
Yeah, who would I be petitioning?
City mayor, office, governor's office, county, courts.
Yeah, see, and that's a big decision. You know, if I'm going for the county, there's county commissioners. So, what I did, one, I started to believe that the hospital district, I believe they had enough resources to do this. And so I was focusing there. So then I had to think about who's in power in the hospital, who controls the hospital district. And in all my years working at the hospital, I was, I believed it was the CEO. The CEO was really the one that was making all the decisions for how the hospital worked. That's always the way I thought about it. I knew there was a board of commissioners that had some role in the hospital, but we never really saw them, never really talked to them. So, but as I thought about it, I realized there is an interesting question there. Who do you talk to, the CEO or the board? So what I did from my job, and I was pretty high up in the organization in the what's called the Performance Improvement Office. I mean, I worked with all the directors, I met with the CEO and Strategic Leadership Group, which is like the officers, all the time. I just started sharing my ideas. What if we did something like Healthy San Francisco? We could do it this way. I just started suggesting it and talking about it. And I started to feel resistance. I started to feel people, I felt some people excited about the idea, but I could feel the institutional resistance to my ideas. So, I pushed on that a little bit, but I was like, this is not fast enough. This, I might make a little progress, but this is nowhere near fast enough. So I was like, basically, after thinking about it, I decided the commission was the way to go because they were the ultimate authority in the district. And even if I convinced the CEO to go full on with what I was thinking, if the commission wasn't on board, then he would have a problem. And so I was like, the commission is the way to go. The authorities of the hospital district, just like Gavin Newsom down in San Francisco, the ones in charge need to be saying, this is what we want to achieve. And so I was like, how do I get the commission to own this, to do this, and to champion this? And these were the, I could have made this, you know, could have asked you guys what you think the possibilities are, but this is what I came up with. I could find someone to run, to be a candidate, and try to, you know, help them win and help them change the priorities of the commission. Or I could do something really crazy, which would be the candidate myself and run for the commission. Only problem is if I won, I couldn't work at the hospital. And a hospital commissioner makes only about $10,000 a year. And I was making about $50,000 a year, and I was working only 30 hours a week. So Thoreau would have been thrilled. He would have been like, you're doing pretty well. You're making good money, working less than the 40 hours a week that Twin Oaks, you know, would have made me do. So this is a very difficult point in my life, a very big decision point. This is, again, where meditation comes in. So I decided to run for office, and that guy is my campaign manager, that guy I'm holding there. He was also an activist with me, but he also was a ran for office himself before Occupy. So I transformed myself into Politician Matt, and that's my campaign photo. And I decided to run. Just deciding whether or not to show you any of these videos. All right, let's see. Let's see if it works. At least I need to know that. Let's see what happens if I click that video link. I'm gonna test it this way.
Everything explodes.
Everything will like all explode.
Yep.
All right.
Let's see. Do we have some audio?
Thank you. So, hello everyone. First off, I just want to thank everyone on the board for your years of service, especially those of you that have many, many years. And I want to thank everyone in the room who helped create and draft the strategic plan for Jefferson Healthcare and drafted it last year. And we're still refining the process. The strategic plan is has made us stronger, has made us more focused.
All right, that's enough of that. So I'd already announced that I was a candidate, but this was the first time I went into the boardroom and spoke publicly and said, this is what I think we should do, what I think the hospital should do. And I guarantee you, this was terrifying. You're going in there and doing this. I mean, I worked at the hospital. It was a high pressure situation. And I also, I bit the bullet and I brought in a video camera and videotaped it because I knew I was gonna use it on my campaign website. So then I was also interviewed by the local paper right after I announced it.
So it was a surprise that you decided to run for hospital for us. Is that something, a decision you've been making for a long time, or tell us about your hospital?
I think about a year ago, I decided, I first had the realization that this was a real possibility. And then I think it was about 3 months ago, it was definite that I was going to run. There were a number of different things I could have tried to try to make some changes. Since I was exploring different options, talking to a lot of people.
All right, so I'm about to say what I already said to you guys, why I decided to run, because I thought that was the only way to make change. So once you run for office, your life transforms. I don't consider it an enjoyable experience, you know, to have all that attention, to have articles written about you, to have, letters to the editor written about you, if there's negative stuff, it's not really fun. But I believed in what I was doing, and I had, which is really important, I had support of people around me. You don't run for office alone. And in fact, I don't think you really do anything significant, activist-wise, alone. You want to have a network of support. So if you have like an idea of something that you want to do, first step is find four or five other people that also want to do something about that. And because you need that kind of support, one, to help you think through what you're doing, and also just that support when things go rough. So another thing I had to do was choose who I was going to run against. There were two people up for election, and so I had control of when I said which opponent I was choosing. I had declared I was running, but I didn't say who I was running against. Everyone wanted to know, my opponents wanted to know, but that was one of the few things I had control over. I didn't have to tell them until I registered, so I didn't tell anybody. I let both these people sitting on the board sweat. Until the last minute, and I decided to run against the president of the board, who was a retired MD and a very right-wing politically, a very right-wing politician. So then we have the whole campaign, we have debates, speeches, door knocking, fundraising, pain, awkwardness. We had some of my old writings come to light during the campaign. I had a blog where I had a lot of pretty free-willing activist things written on this blog, one of which was that corporations are evil effing monsters. So that came out a few weeks before Election Day. But I, you know, you just bite the bullet and you speak honestly. The reason I did, you know, when the journalist asked me about that, I said I shouldn't have called them evil monsters. She was nice enough to leave out that I called them evil effing monsters. She just said I called them evil monsters. And I said I should have called them sociopathic monsters. Because they're not necessarily evil, they're just, corporations are just sociopaths. They just care about money. They care nothing about emotions or humanity. They are abstract entities we create for a purpose. They do not have a heart or a soul. So they're sociopaths, and we should treat them like sociopathic robots and not like human beings, so that we can control them. Anyways, that got in. My response got into the article, and I didn't know if that had blown the whole election for me, but did not. I won. I won, yeah. And this is another thing I did during the campaign. I met with Sherry Appleton. She's a Washington State representative because she is the sponsor of a single-payer healthcare bill for Washington State. And so I called her up, said, I'm running. I'm going to be totally talking about your bill. She met with me, and she endorsed me. And so I was probably the first, I bet I was the first public hospital district candidate to get endorsed by a state representative so blatantly. That was pretty cool. So I won. I won by 200 votes. I immediately resigned from my job, and I start learning everything I can about how the heck to do this public hospital commissioner thing and try to actually now make change. Because now I am 20% of the powers over the board. There's five hospital commissioners, and I'm only one vote, and they all campaigned against me. They hate me. I mean, or they did. They really, I mean, you could feel the hostility when I joined that commission. Do I really want to say it that way? I'm videotaping this. Maybe I'll cut that little piece out. They welcomed me onto the commission, and it was a great experience. And it was really fascinating learning about how the heck power really works. So now we're going into me as activist politician. And I had two goals: single payer healthcare, push from the commission level, and try to solve the access to healthcare problem. I had to figure out how to do that, especially with not having the majority power on the board. It's been a long story. I'm going to tell you about a few of the interesting moments where I really had to make some big decisions of what tactics to take. The first one was that you would sit in the boardroom, and this goes back to the egalitarian facilitation thing, where it's really important to decide who gets to speak and how long they get to speak. I mean, that's how that's power, you know? Verbal space, and I'm taking up all this verbal space in this room right now, talking so much. But the verbal space in the room is a resource that we are, in any time you enter a room, you are agreeing how you're gonna share that resource. That's why it's important to me to say, raise your hand if you wanna talk, because I'm not gonna sit here and just like talk down your throats. But in a boardroom, or in a legislature, it gets really important who controls who speaks. And so we get in there, and I want to talk about some stuff. And so I raise my hand. They weren't even raising their hand. They were just sort of like talking. And so I was like, I'm being polite, and I raise my hand, and I would speak. But the chair would cut me off and just be like, we don't have time, man. Just try to move on. And it was very aggressive. And people came up to me after the meeting, and they were like, that was really, I mean, they found it uncomfortably rude, the way they were trying to just keep me from even talking. And so I had to think, okay, how am I gonna deal with this? What tactic do I use? Any ideas? What do you do if you're in a, what?
Aggressively assert.
Aggressively assert, yeah, I could do that. I could just like raise my voice, yeah.
Maybe outside resources.
Outside resources? Yeah? I'm I'm not sure who, I mean, police or something, I don't know, security guard?
Black man.
What?
Black man.
I'm not even responding to that.
Whoa.
Can you use evidence to support your case? So instead of just stating your opinion, you're putting up with facts, it's kind of hard to deny a fact.
You would think so, but if they don't even let you speak your evidence, then you're kind of in a bind there. It's really a tricky situation. So the first thing I did was I asked, what are the rules of this room? Do you have any rules? Or is this literally just a slugfest of who speaks the loudest and longest? And the truth is they didn't really have, they said they followed Robert's rules. Everyone, who's heard of Robert's rules? No? Robert's rules is basically the way every political body in this country works. It's the whole, there is someone that's the chair of the room, and someone, the chair recognizes people, and then you can make motions, and a motion has to be seconded.
Oh.
Yeah, that's Robert. That's all Robert's rules, created by this guy named
Robert.
That's right. So they said they were following Robert's rules in theory, but they weren't actually following them. But because they said they were, I could just refer to that. So I guess I did what you said. That's the outside, who said outside authority? Outside, yeah. So that's what I did. I was like, the outside authority was the rules that they said they were using. And I tried to use that. But they still were, the chair still has a lot of power in Robert's rules, so they can cut you off. And the other thing they can do is just ignore your suggestion. Like I can make a motion and they can just, no one seconds it, we don't even have to talk about it. And so I'm really dead in the water there. So I was like, I don't want to sit on this board for 6 years and just be walked over and not have any of my motions even considered or discussed. So the tactic I came up with was, I'm gonna record every meeting and share the audio on my website, and I'm going to write up transcripts of any interesting exchanges because I want the public to know what I'm doing. I mean, if they wanted to sit there and ignore everything I said and use what I considered really weak arguments against me when they did respond, I'm going to at least let everyone that voted for me and everyone in my county know exactly what's happening. And I was like, I could do that for 6 years. That would be fine. Because that's really, I mean, that's all I had power over. I just wanted people to know what I was trying to do and see if maybe, that would stir things up. It would create openings. And these are public meetings. Anyone can record a public meeting in Washington State. You can walk in with a video camera. I forgot to ask that. So I'm recording this. So anyone that asks a question and you don't want your voice on there, if you could just tell me that and I'll like edit your voice out of the video if I do anything with it. Does anyone want to tell me? You can tell me now or you can tell me after. Anyone have any concerns with me recording? Okay. So, in a public meeting, anyone can record the meeting. That was what I decided to do. So I emailed all the commissioners and I said, heads up, I'm gonna start recording these meetings and sharing the audio. That turned into massive conflict. Probably the biggest, most intense conflict that I've ever been a part of for an extended period of time. As you can see from the end here. In the end, no one had any objection that actually held enough weight to stop the recording. They came up with a lot of different arguments to say it was different for a hospital commissioner to record. They tried to say because I was a commissioner, if I was recording, it was now an act of the hospital, and the board has to decide if they're recording, so I can't record it because I am a commissioner. And I said, I disagree. And they said, well, we have a lawyer that says we're right. And I said, I don't care. And I kept recording. That's basically the story, but it was much more long and painful than that. In fact, thanks for talking about it. Let's see, we've got.
So
this is actually the, this is actually recently, this is the video recording of the first meeting, or an audio recording of the first meeting where I recorded, and there's sort of a long discussion here, but we had a, this is one recently where I pulled out my recorder, and I'm going to let you just hear a little bit of what happened.
I'm recording.
Are we not?
We're still on policies.
Wait, is this an official meeting?
It's an official board meeting, but our policy states that we record when we're in our normal board situation, board meeting room at the hospital.
Well, there's nothing that prohibits Matt from recording. So,
yes, there is. It makes it official record.
Should be an official record if it's an official meeting.
Well, there is a legal opinion that recommends to not do this. Actually, but we talked about that. And you're right.
I guess that's before my time. So.
Yeah. Okay. So we're just not being different.
You still recording?
I'm recording the meeting.
Okay.
We'll see you guys later.
You walked out of the room.
Well, you come back.
I know he turns it off.
Eventually. Stretching the silence in the boardrooms. They're all waiting. I'm just like, my stress level was off the charts.
Sorry, my stress level is very high right now, so it's hard for me to. I did not expect a massive conflict over this again.
Right.
I didn't think you guys would be surprised. I recorded last year's meeting, if you recall. So, I told you before. I cannot actually remember everything that is said at these meetings. And it's important to me that we take what we say here seriously, that we're held accountable for what we say here. The only way to do that is to have an accurate record of these meetings. And so I record the meetings.
And then they went on their 10 minutes of coming up with trying reasons to try to stop me. And eventually they stopped the meeting. We just didn't have a meeting at all. Yeah.
So I found it very interesting that I don't know who the person is, but the lady said it was counterproductive, but the fact was that discussing this whole matter of you recording when you've already done it before was actually more counterproductive than what could have gone on about. Because I'm assuming you guys don't talk about just recordings at hospital commissions. Like, you're supposed to talk about other things.
Yeah, we have other topics to talk about.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just have one question. So, like, are these meetings annually or are they
twice a month?
Twice a month. Okay.
Twice a month meeting.
Someone walked out.
Cool. Yeah.
I just think it's very interesting. You're so worked up over this. I mean, do you really have so much to worry about that you can't be open with who you're making decisions for in the first place? Like, why can't, if you don't feel bad about it and you feel like you're doing the right thing, why are you so upset that the people you're affecting know what you're doing? I find that really weird.
Clearly,
yeah.
they're more worried about what they're going to say than actually doing something.
And if you don't feel guilty, what's problem?
I'm with you.
And I know, because I used to be a recorder for a nonprofit organization, that you're supposed to have some kind of recording for every board meeting on the street.
Well, it's not legally required of public hospital districts, but so they weren't breaking the law. That would have been
optional.
Easy. It's optional.
Yes.
I'm wondering, like, why they like are against you so much? Is it because of like money, or is it just like the beliefs?
Bet you they just don't want to be accountable for what they say.
Yep. It's a good question. Why? And there's four of them, so there's, or there. Yeah.
What do you want us to know, to learn about your experience, considering that we are, some of us, not activists at all, some who are thinking about becoming activists? What could you clarify for me? What could I take away from the experience that you've talked about so far?
Sure. Well, I think basically just, one, being an activist just means you're trying to change something. You're just actively trying to change something in the world. And so I'm just sort of sharing at my journey through, at times I wanted to change different things, and it's basically a journey of choosing tactics. It's always choosing actions. I mean, whether or not it's activism in a political sense or in your life, you're always choosing tactics. And so, I just sort of wanted people to get a taste of these moments when I had to make a decision of what to do. And so there's different ways you can make those decisions. One, like in the boardroom there, you have to make the decision on the spot. Pressure is there, and you have to know, you have to decide right there, high pressure. And I use meditation a lot to sort of like pause things there to try to stretch out the amount of time I get to think what to do. And then there's decisions that are, that you have more time, where you can sort of brainstorm different actions. And then as we get to the end, we'll go to my actual like solution that I'm working on. All right.
Can I just ask the class, are you starting to, I think it's fascinating. I'm on 3 pages of taking notes. Have you come up with ideas that to help you with your own project, or?
Yes.
Oh, great.
Okay, so more little activist tactical decision making that I had to do. I'll just take you through this. I want Washington State to really get behind single payer healthcare. So how do I do that from the commission level? It has a state level bill that's under consideration. I thought, to start with, I could get the board to discuss it. So my first tactic was just ask them to discuss it. Like, hey, there's a big single-payer bill. Are we willing to talk about it? They agreed. It's really, especially, and it helped that the meetings were being recorded. If I wasn't recording the meetings, it would be very easy for them to say, to dismiss it. But it's when you're being recorded, it puts pressure on you to say something that you can defend later, and that you look a little bit better to the public. And so it brought some of the better selves out of my fellow commissioners. So they agreed to discuss it. I said, if we decide we're for or against it, we should say so, and they agreed to that. And then they agreed to schedule a meeting to discuss single payer, a future meeting. And so then I decided to try to raise the energy of that meeting, that I put the word out to activists that this was happening. I also was the one that organized the presentations. And we had a big meeting, a lot of people from the public, and we ended up being the first public hospital district to pass a resolution in favor of single payer healthcare. That was pretty cool. Also, as a part of this, these are two experts that I networked with to bring in, and this is Steve Theringer. Anyone know who Steve Theringer is? State representative, like Sherry Appleton earlier. So that's me sitting on a panel at the local Unitarian Fellowship talking about single payer. This is a week before that big board meeting. So that's one thing, a little bit of progress. Then I have my next tactic, again, just trying to get universal health care in our state, was trying to get all public hospital districts to do what my this public hospital district did. And so how to do that? I decided, you know, I'm going to try to network with other commissioners. You know, again, because when I go to these conferences and all these public hospital commissioners are there, I was a very small, lonely voice in trying to talk about single payer healthcare. And so I had to, like I said, you have to build your strength in numbers. And so I networked, found some allies, and I've been doing that for about 2.5 years. And we're up to about 20 public hospital commissioners that really want to get this talked about, and we're putting putting pressure on the Washington State Hospital Association, which is a huge, powerful organization, and the Association of Washington Public Hospital Districts to try to get them to start discussing it. But they're currently saying no, basically. They're refusing to discuss single-payer healthcare. And so now we're sort of blocked. So again, we have to decide what to do. So any ideas? So imagine you have a big organization and it's a club, and you're a member of this club, and you want them to actually support an issue. But to get them to support it, you want them to first talk about it, and they're refusing to talk about it. What do you do?
Keep talking.
Okay.
Well, you can possibly plant seeds into those groups and then have them discuss it that way by someone they know bringing it up, like inside their group instead of someone outside of their group trying to come in and discuss it.
Sure, so plant seeds in the people to try to get, okay, good.
Maybe since you have other boards to work with, maybe form like a kind of leader of each board, and then those, it's like a meeting within a meeting, basically, essentially get a consensus of like, hey, would you guys be willing to bring this up in your commission?
Good, and that's actually something we're starting to do now. So we're starting, we've got two other public hospital district boards have passed. They're not quite resolutions in favor of single payer, but they're in favor of asking this organization to discuss it at our big conferences. Is there another suggestion?
I just thought it was interesting how you use like transparency basically to fight like their want to like shun that topic, so maybe something along those lines again.
Excellent. Yeah, and right now in telling you guys and recording this, I'm going very transparent about Wisha and AW PhD resisting talking about single payer healthcare. Yeah, transparency is amazing. Sunlight is a disinfectant. You know, anywhere that BS is happening, just shine transparency, shine sunlight on it. It makes everyone behave a little better, and it creates a, what I call, it creates you a thread of truth. A video record or an audio record of what happened, it gives you a thread of truth that gives you strength as long as you are being honest about what happened and what you're talking about, what you said and what you believe. And it gives you something to fall back on if other people are inconsistent or they are changing, they're changing their mind, or they're just using really, really bad arguments. Transparency is a really powerful thing.
With these tactics and subtactics, did you find that the board was, over time, more consistent or more inconsistent?
The recording helped them be more consistent and elevated the level of the conversation in the room, I'd say. At the conferences, part of networking was just getting up out of my seat and walking around to every table and just walking up to a table and saying, is anyone here a public hospital commissioner? I would ignore everyone else at the table, and whoever said they were, I would just look at them and say, do you support single-payer healthcare? And they would tell me yes or no. If they said yes, I'd like, you want to talk about it sometime? And they'd say yes or no. If they said yes, wrote it down, moved on, and set up a meeting. Really uncomfortable for me. I'm an introvert. I don't like going up to people and talking to them. But you know, you do the tactic that has the most possibility for success, not the tactic that feels good. Because it's often the awkward, uncomfortable tactics that have the most result. And that's pretty much true about everything in life. Just a life tip. I also tried to go to a board meeting of the AW PhD. I just went to it and just walked in the room. They were starting to get set up, and the director of the AW PhD came up to me and said, hi, Matt, why are you here? And I was like, I want to you know, observe the board meeting, see what you guys talk about, see who's on the board. And he said, well, you can't, and you have to leave. And so, elected public hospital commissioner was not allowed to observe the board of the Association of Washington Public Hospital Districts. And I was like, well, who's on the board? And he's like, it's all CEOs, and basically. And I was like, well, can a public hospital commissioner sit on the board? He's like, oh no, it's in the bylaws. It has to, only elected hospital commissioners cannot be on the board of the association that is basically the trade organization of all public hospital districts. I was like, well, that's interesting. So, and that also sort of opened my eyes to these associations are controlled by, they're controlled by CEOs, basically, administrators. And that means they're never gonna be controlled. Even if I got all the public hospital commissioners to say they wanted to do something, they wouldn't have control of that organization. So that led to another tactic, which possibility of creating a different organization, of a network of public hospital commissioners, potentially just going that route, just going around your obstacle. Haven't done that yet, but it's one of the things that we talked about in our group of 20. Let's see, what else we got here? Okay, so that was a dive into my political sort of journey. But I want to come back to the big picture of activism, the world. So I kind of consider my work in politics sort of like a hobby. What I really care about is trying to help alleviate oppression in the world. You know, I believe we have a beautiful planet here. I believe there's enough resources for us to share the resources so every human on Earth should be able to live a reasonably thriving life. But the problem with our world is the power pyramids that are everywhere. Every country, basically, has a power pyramid, because every country is a type of hierarchy, whether it has a king or a president or a legislature or an oligarchy at the top, or warlords, dictators. Everyone fits into this power pyramid in some way, and it's very difficult. It's very difficult to imagine how to disrupt that. I mean, human history is the story of power pyramids being created and eventually power being abused and people being oppressed and people at the bottom of the pyramid finally getting fed up and tearing the whole thing down, having a big revolution. And then what happens? What happens after a revolution? Anyone know? I couldn't tell what anyone said.
Reconstruction of the government.
A new government, some sort of new government is built. That's the way it's always been. We create some sort of new power pyramid. And the cycle just repeats. But something has changed in the last
decades.
I'd say the last 50 years, you know, and it really was the internet. The internet has created a situation where, for the first time, the vast majority of people in any country can be connected and communicate. And potentially, if we figure out how to do it, they could figure out how to use the internet as a way to control our collective power. And basically communication to control our collective power. And this is the, I actually believe this is the destiny of the internet and technology. It is going to help us create societies that are more egalitarian than anything we've ever seen before in human history. Because we could never do it before. If you didn't have the internet, you had telegraph, you can't ask a million people to help you with a decision. If your communication is so slow, it takes a year to get any sort of response. But with the internet, you could potentially ask a million people a question and get an answer in 10 minutes. So with the internet, and I'm gonna take you on a little journey. This is how I see the evolution of the internet. This is Usenet. The first big thing that really started to unite people and unite human knowledge was news groups and bulletin board systems. Anyone ever use that? News groups, do you know what I'm talking about? They still exist, not really very popular among the young folk. So this I mentioned earlier, Dig. Dig was one of the first sites to say anyone can submit a link or to anything and then you just vote it up, you would dig it, and then it would help percolate the better ideas, more popular ideas to the top. Then there's, of course, bulletin boards or message boards, and there's these are all text-based forums. Reddit is basically, I think, the biggest, most significant text-based social forum. And then in the last 10 years, video has really started to become something that is ubiquitous, something that is everywhere, that anyone with a smartphone now has the capability not only of recording a video, but of doing live video. I mean, I could pull out my phone right now and I could go live on YouTube or Facebook, and potentially the whole world could be watching. And everyone, actually, I bet there's probably enough, we could probably have 10 live feeds going on right now if everyone pulled out their phones and started doing it. This changes the formula of how power and communication works. And it's changing revolution. This is from Occupy Wall Street. And this is different. This is something that people that squash revolutions and that, this is gonna change the formula of how revolution works, and it already has. The Arab Spring, this is the global Occupy movement map. But before the global Occupy movement, really started in the Arab Spring. And the thing that was different there was all of the video cameras that were going on. This is Tahrir Square, Egypt. So there's two things, two really important things to know about from this picture. One is that these two guys, they changed the whole, I think the course of history, because they documented and they collected, they did live video and they were networking online. And this was an incredibly well-documented revolution. The other thing to really take away from this is making change, again, is about taking space. This is a central square, and by occupying a central square in a society, you are saying, my message is important. And so basically the whole Egyptian revolution was about taking the square. They didn't have to like fight wars. They didn't have to fight battles. There were some, but the battles were around the square because the government felt, and they were right, if the people were holding the square and saying something needed to change, because people were so fed up, it was like a rallying point and it brought people together. So many people did die in trying to hold this square, but this was it. It was about this central space, and they could not, once the masses came, they could not stop the revolution, and the leader had to step down. Now again, things have not gone great, all that great since then, but... Now these guys, they did all their documenting of this revolution, and the square is a movie that they put together. It's on Netflix, really fascinating story, I strongly recommend. Ukraine also had a very well documented revolution, which is still a pretty big mess, but that's another Winter on Fire, another really fascinating documentary. You will learn just a ton, just absorbing, just on the front lines of what these people are going through. And I watched these two movies and you'll see so many similarities in Ukraine and Egypt and what it feels like. I mean, it's like people are the same everywhere. We all want a better world, and we all want to try to make it a world where everyone can thrive. It's just hard to figure out how to do it. So a couple years after these, the Arab Spring, this happened. This is Hong Kong. And a movement erupted in Hong Kong for democracy. Anyone know what country is in charge of Hong Kong?
China.
So, that is true. China is in charge of Hong Kong, but Hong Kong is kind of like Puerto Rico is to the US. It is, I think it's called a protectorate. So it's not a part of mainland China, which is important. But in any case, it is ultimately controlled by China. And when I saw that this democracy movement was erupting in China, it really caught my attention. And it really got me fired up. Because there's been democracy movements in China before. Anyone know when? Anyone know a major democracy movement in China in the last 40 years?
It's a long time.
Anyone know this picture? Tiananmen Square, 1989. There was a massive democracy movement in 89. And it was, if you watch documentaries about this, it was an amazing, powerful populist movement centered again around a central spot, Tiananmen Square. They occupied the square, college students. And then the only way that the powers in Beijing, China, could squash it, they sent in tanks. They sent in, my understanding is, they sent the tanks in, and they told the soldiers and the generals, we don't want anyone hurt, you know, because people were getting hurt and people were getting upset. And we don't want anyone hurt, but we want the square cleared by the morning. Giving sort of mixed signals because no one wanted to really own what they were telling them to do. And about 2,000 people, they estimate, were killed. But this is one of the most, to me, this is one of the most important images that you'll ever see in your life. Because it shows you the incredible power of action. Because these tanks, this was the day after 2,000 people had been crushed and the tanks were just like doing a display and coming down this road, and this guy who's carrying his groceries just walked out there and stood in front of the tanks. And again, this is what activism comes down to. Where are you standing and why are you standing there? Because when you know what you're doing and why you're doing it, you can stop an army. Gotta tell you, the guy driving that tank, he didn't know why he was driving that tank down the road. He didn't know what he should do. He didn't want to kill anybody. I mean, this is like the most powerful act I've ever seen a human do. And he actually like got up on the tank, and this guy, if you watch video of this, he got up on there and the tanks tried to go around him, and that is the power of activism. That's why they went in and they crushed the Occupy camps. They have to move you out of the power spaces. And so if you know where the power is in your community, you can change anything. You go and you literally stand or sit for what you believe in. Now, of course, it was a powerful moment. No one really knows what happened to him afterwards. So, back to Hong Kong. Students had come out and they had actually stormed the government building. Not violently, they just stormed it and overwhelmed it, and they were sitting in it, and more students came out. The Hong Kong police were sent out and started pepper spraying everyone and trying to get them to disperse. The students got umbrellas and raincoats and goggles, and they stayed there. They held their ground. They weren't violent. So I was watching this, and I was like, oh my gosh. I mean, this is incredible. What's happening there? Don't know how this is going to go, because I'm thinking about Tiananmen Square. I'm like, when's China going to send in tanks? These are just some images, people that were down there. And again, it was student-led. This is a teacher saying that he tutors drama, see students on the street, I get upset, and as an adult, I need to come out and support and stand in front. So the students inspired many adults to go out, but not, but it was mainly student-led. So pepper spray wasn't working. So you know the people that are in charge of Hong Kong, they called up Beijing and they said, pepper spray is not getting these students out of the streets. What do we do?
Tear gas.
They escalate to tear gas. This has never been done in Hong Kong before. They tear gassed the students. Chaos, and the students come back. Tear gas did not get them to leave.
Yeah. Albeit better than being shot.
Yes. Well, see, that's what I'm sitting here thinking. They just escalated to tear gas and it didn't work. So what's going to happen next? Is it going to go to guns and tanks?
Do they do like beanbag rounds and rubber bullets and stuff, or did they not go that far?
I don't think they, at this point, they hadn't gone that far.
I was going to say, because this is 2014, so what happened?
Yeah, hey, we're getting there.
Yeah. Let's head a cart.
So, tear gas happened, and this is, again, I want to go back to where I was. So I was sitting here, just like watching this, and I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm going to sit here and we're going to see another Tiananmen Square. We're going to see these students get slaughtered. And so I was like, I want to help. I was like, I don't want to sit here. And there's people actually getting, potentially they're going to get killed. So I was like, what can I do? He's like, I wanted to be active in this. I wanted to do something. I was like, I could start Facebooking it to support it. I could start blogging about it. I could maybe make some videos about it. I could send money or supplies.
Of all the interruptions we have. Who's doing your artwork while
it's pouring? Man, weed whacking in the rain. The second weed whacker I saw today. Okay. So, we're trying to connect online with protesters. I did some of all this because I did feel that I could help. You know, I was like, I just want to, like, for whoever's protesting, I was like, I can help you. I'm an activist organizer. I'm a very good tactical thinking. I was like, this is a big deal. I want to help you guys. But I wasn't satisfied with all this. So, you know, meditating, this is what came up for me. I could go there. Didn't really know what I could do if I went there, but I was like,
arm the students.
Arm them? Yeah, no.
They have two arms already. They don't need more.
You're not going to win a lot of these fights, a lot of these struggles with actual violence. But I decided to go there. So I went, I bought a ticket, flew to Hong Kong, and I just went to the protest sites. I mean, they took over the city, these students. They had blocked like four major areas. One, this is a highway. It's the equivalent of blocking I-5 in downtown Seattle. And they had tents, and it was completely blocked, completely shut down. And this was, when I got there, it had been shut down for like 10 days or 2 weeks already. And this was the scene.
Wow.
Place, well, they had taken these barricades, these metal, they had blocked roads, and this is a government building they had blocked, and they just swarmed the city. They had protest messages plastered all over the place. They had all sorts of interesting tactics going on. Universal suffrage without civil nomination. They wouldn't let, I don't know if I actually said that point. Did I explain what they were specifically protesting? They don't get to elect. They get to vote for their leader, but Beijing selects the candidates.
Oh.
So they're like, this is pointless. It's kind of like, you know.
I was going to say, that sounds familiar.
Yeah, it's kind of like the US, where corporations and corporate money chooses our candidates. But they were like fed up with it. And these are just some images from some of the young people that led this. This was in a square, a very busy square that they had taken over. And they were surrounded by very heavy claustrophobic business district. And they had a mic, and they would people would get up, and they would share the mic, and they would say, give their speeches and say what they have to say. And I was just sort of sitting, bearing witness. I was like, if nothing else, I'm going to sit here with camera, and I'm going to document, because if the tanks do come, I'm going to at least be, I didn't know what I would do, actually. I'll be honest. I might have.
RPGs.
No, seriously. I mean, what do you do if someone is getting physically oppressed or about to get, you know, or about to get beat up by cops? You know, if you're standing there, especially if you're in another country, but you're standing there and someone, like a student, is getting pressured by a line of cops. You know, it's like, what do you do?
Why didn't you bring your tank to Hong Kong?
Yeah. I brought my camera. Camera's a powerful thing. And I think that's what stopped the tanks from going into Hong Kong, because there were cameras everywhere. Anytime there was a slight confrontation, you'd see like 50 cell phones come up immediately, and it was being filmed or live streamed. It created, I think, almost like a magic safety bubble. I mean, people did get beat up and hurt, but once they got beat up and hurt, they got photographed, and the pictures of the people that got hurt and that were bloody were just plastered all over the city. So it was like instant shaming of the people using violence. I enjoyed taking pictures of the old Chinese men who would walk up. I mean, I know people that live through Tiananmen Square who were there and alive, who are sitting there like, are you kids crazy? You know, do you know what China's gonna do to you if you keep doing this? And they would just stop on the street, you know, going their way, and they would just stare at it. And I just found it, you know, you could see inspiration, you could see fear in their eyes. I like this one. This is a serious, like, I don't know what's going to happen in this city now. There's a tactic. They put up this all over, plastered all over the city. Again, this is messages straight to the police trying to tell them, don't use violence. You are committing an international crime if you use violence against these peaceful protesters. And they put up things like this, saying this is what the government is doing, this is what we're doing. They're hurting unarmed citizens, beating with batons, using pepper spray, tear gas, threatening gunfire, colluding with triad. Those are as a gang organized crime in Hong Kong, that there was a lot of evidence the government was actually paying thugs from the gangs to go and beat up protesters, just start fights or sexually assault the young girls that were there. Yeah.
I was wondering, could you go back to the last slide? I was just wondering, do you happen to know what the Nuremberg principles are? I don't want you to expand on everything, but I just never heard of the Nuremberg principles.
I believe that's a reference to rules of that came out of World War II, sort of in like what the Nazis did, try to say.
Okay.
We have some level of, even in war, of what is okay.
I don't mean to keep you going back.
No.
Did the principles come out of the Nuremberg trials that happened post-World War II?
Yeah. I think you're onto something there.
Let's Google this.
Yeah. But that's a good one, because it's like it's a powerful little reference they're using. Yeah, it was weird while I was there. There were a lot of young people, and the women, the young girls, the college girls and high school girls that were there, they also created a sort of safety bubble. Because it's really hard for the police to come and beat up a bunch of students if there's, it's one thing to beat up a bunch of guys and to have pictures of guys bloody, you know, it's okay, but not okay, but it's easier for a society to stomach. But young girls getting hurt, it really prevented a lot of escalation of violence. And so what they tried to do, they tried to scare the girls away by threatening sexual assault. They actually had it. They had it being said in the press, we cannot keep girls safe. We should stay home. And they did. There were some instances of attempted sexual assault. But again, the protesters just had to, you know, they see, okay, these are the tactics they're using. We're going to change our tactics of how we're going to keep people safe. And it just fascinated me how they took over this city. I mean, just blatantly challenging the government to the government headquarters. What is democracy? Democracy is the freedom to elect our own dictators.
That's clever.
Oh, man.
So I met Lori Wen on the streets of Hong Kong during the protest. She grew up in Hong Kong until she was 12. She did the exact same thing I did. She was actually living in New York, and when they started the tear gas, she just bought a ticket and flew there. And I interviewed her on my podcast, which I'll tell you a little bit more about. So, this was going to be a question. Who's the highest ranking U.S. politician to visit Hong Kong umbrella movement protest
Mr.
sites?
Not
Hospital
you.
Commissioner Matt Reddy. Yeah. So then I come back home, back to the hospital. and an election comes up, and I decide to, fortunately for me, a couple people were willing to run for office on the hospital board, and so there were a couple campaigns that went, and I felt they would be stronger allies on the board, and so I supported them both, and this guy actually won. So now I have another pretty strong voice on the board to work with me. And again, that's another tactic. That's working within the system, politics. If you're in a political system, running candidates is a way to change the power dynamic. Okay, so now we're gonna get into my big strategy for how to fix the world, how to fix power in the world. It's about global consensus. It's about how do you bring the power of consensus decision-making, egalitarian decision-making to the whole world so that millions or even billions of people can wield power together.
Yeah. Stop recording. No, I'm joking.
Stop recording?
Yeah, I was joking.
So we need to be able to do this in a way that is fast, efficient, and fun. It has to scale to billions. I think it's basically the way social media is evolving. You know, Facebook. Facebook is this, the idea of Facebook is it connects everyone, right? Connects billions of people. But we don't use Facebook as a tool for collective decision making. But I think we could evolve social media into a tool for collective decision making. And part of this, part of getting to that level, is leveraging full audio and video. Because again, there's a problem on the internet with trolls, people becoming trolls. Everyone know what I mean by a troll?
Yes.
Maybe. Oh, wait. No one knows that.
And I think people are comfortable being so mean on the internet because of the anonymity. And again, it sort of gives you this barrier. You just let your worst self out because no one knows it's you. But there's no reason that we have to have collective platforms where there's that anonymity. You can have platforms where you have to say who you are, and you have to show your face, or you have to say what you have to say out loud now. And so that, I think we leverage that, and again, it will sort of bring out a little bit of the better selves of people, and we can create safer environments. So I've been working on this and thinking about this for a while. And the Global Consensus Project and Hive One are the two websites where you can learn more about it, and I'll show you a little bit with it. Basically, the idea is that we're basically sort of building a global hive mind of human minds, or a network of hive minds. And I like the hive metaphor because it's better than the Borg metaphor. But my idea is that in a really functional human hive mind decision-making platform that's totally egalitarian, no one is forced to pay attention to anything. No one is forced to listen to anything. No one's forced to stay silent or limit their expression. No one is forced in any way. It's all volunteer participation. And it's safe. And it's an environment that stimulates brainstorming, listening, speaking, exploring, and expression together. It's basically help us find answers together in more efficient ways.
Amen.
Yeah.
I mean, it might just be me, but is there anybody else that doesn't know what a hive mind or a Borg mind is? Everybody else knows but me?
I
originally
had
four different.
Oh, you did?
Oh,
okay.
Well, I mean, a hive is like a beehive, right? In a hive or an anthill, you know, all these members of the hive are working together in some sort of team-like way.
Teamwork.
Yeah, But the hive analogy breaks down a little bit because in a lot of hives there is a queen, so there is like a, yeah. Is that what you're gonna say?
Yes.
So we're talking about something that we don't really have a metaphor for, a hive that is perfectly egalitarian. And I might be wrong, there might be hives that don't have queens. But.
You mentioned it like a brain.
Yeah.
And each person has their node.
Yeah.
So is it like, how do you, in the system, how would you like to overview?
Right. Well, I'm going to show you a little bit of it, and we'll see how that does for us. And one reason, because I know this is a very hard concept to understand. And so I have built the beginning of this platform, but I've started a podcast, which is basically just, because everyone knows what a podcast or a webcast or a video show is. And so that is my vehicle for trying to introduce people to it. It's just watch. Anyone interested can start to watch the video webcast, and we're going to interact with the Hive platform. And hopefully that'll be a way for people to start to understand how it can work, and for me to understand how it can work, because this is a very new idea. And these are just images from the podcast where I interview activists, and I just interview people, but I ask everyone that I interview, are you an activist? Just like I asked you guys. We talk about different things. Okay, so now we're gonna go a little bit into the Hive platform, and we'll see if it makes any sense to you guys. So this is the main interface currently for the Hive platform. And it's basically designed to allow for egalitarian facilitation. I've said that several times. It's how do you make, how do you take a room full of people and make it so everyone is equal in making a decision, whether it's ordering a pizza or choosing whether or not we invade a country or whatever. And so one thing that has to happen is someone has to be able to facilitate the room. And so in this case, I'm the facilitator. This person, the facilitator, has control over this, which is basically like a room in the Hive. And the facilitator can state a topic or a question here, and that becomes the focus of everyone that's in this room. And then anyone in the room can submit an answer, and it comes up in this thread of answers. And anyone in the room can vote up or down any of these answers. And that sort of becomes one way that the Hive percolates up ideas. With me so far?
Yes.
All right. That's not all that unusual for the internet. But each of these links, if you click on one of those, it becomes another room. And so if you want to go into, if you want to go and talk about theater activism, you click on that, and now you're in a new room with a new facilitator and potentially all new information here. The facilitator also has the power to put up to 4 videos here of information related to whatever this topic is. My vision of this is that it would be live. The middle video here would be a live person talking to people in this room, which could have thousands or millions of people in it. And again, anyone participating, anyone in the room can express themselves in a couple different ways. You can answer the question. You can also do a sparkle up, sparkle down, or raise your hand. This came out of the Occupy movement, or at least for me, it came out of the Occupy movement. It's a way of, you look at a room of people and you say, who likes pizza? You just go like this if you like pizza. So, who likes ice cream? Yeah, so it's like a quick way. So, who wants to end this meeting right now? You know, you can sparkle up and that's, you know, when I'm facilitating, I'm constantly asking, how's everyone feel about extending this topic 10 minutes? And you get sparkle really quick, instant information from a group of people. It's a very powerful tool. Sparkle up, sparkle down. Or sparkle straight out means I'm not sure. Anyone ever seen these before?
Nope.
Familiar with it? Very powerful tool. And also, in a lot of groups, you can do this at any time. So it's not just when the facilitator asks you a question, or what do we want to do, anytime someone is talking, someone you can just go like this, or go like this, and you're communicating in that moment how you feel about what's being said, but you're doing it in a way that is not oppressive to them, as opposed to, I mean, even applause is a little bit oppressive because it stops the speaker from being able to speak if it gets too loud. And of course, yelling or, you know, whistling or hissing at someone is a way also.
So how hard is this to set up? I mean, is it something that people in this room we can easily do? Would it be, is anybody wondering that, if they would want to, Jane, were you talking about doing something with the internet, or?
Yeah, I'm
Yeah, I mean, you could easily do an online quiz here with this. And yes, you guys could use this right now. So I'll just sort of take you through it. I'll go back to the beginning here.
Fox.
Yeah. So this is these are the Genesis nodes. It starts with basically there's like starter nodes for this hive, and so I have one for the mindful activist, and so that's one I control for my podcast, and I put ideas in there, and you follow the threads of the ideas. So. I have right here, this is my first focus for the mindful activist. You can ask me any question, and these are some topics that are there. And if you're interested in one, you can go into it, and you can put more links or answers, and each one can have each time you enter any sort of answer here, you can associate a video, a YouTube video, by putting the video, YouTube video code right there. And it becomes the video that comes up when someone clicks on it. And then if you are creating the node, you can add the other videos that you want over here. So if you wanted to play with this, what you would do is you would go into the test node, and you just, right here, where I said what test nodes exist for personal use, and you would just put whatever you want here to be the name of your first branch in this hive mind. It could be about anything, it could be your name, but then once you have it, once you go into it, you're going to be the facilitator immediately of the first node you create. So you can state whatever question you want or statement here. You can invite people. You can answer the question here and invite people to vote on them, or you can invite people to give answers.
So who's the audience?
It's whoever you invite to.
So you have to invite people into it.
Well, until there's a community that's actually there. And you have to log in using Facebook to participate, because that Facebook is the way you identify yourself to this as hopefully a semi-real person. Yeah.
A lot of the problems that I kind of see in actually today, like you said, have to do with bigger corporations, travel, you know, and a lot of times, like, you know, these things like this aren't that interesting. Like, people our age just don't kind of watch stuff like this. So I was wondering if you have any thoughts.
The youth? Did you say get the youth more interested?
Yeah, or just everybody.
More interested in
making a change, like in the power.
Yeah, how to get people interested in I don't try to manipulate what people are interested in. You know, I think the key to making positive change in the world is that you go to where you want to make the change and where you want to make the difference. And what happens instead is people see you take action and they are inspired by you or they're affected by you, and you can invite them. I mean, if you go, like, a lot of people in our community are doing a lot about Standing Rock and the fight over the oil pipeline in the Dakotas. They're talking about it and they're doing events, you know, organizing some sort of forum or protest event, and they are networking, and you know, all you can really do is invite people. That's all you can. And then if they come, that's a really important step. The next step is, how do you hold the space when you invite people in? Because if you invite people into a space and you want them to learn about something, you have to really decide, you know, how are you going to do that? Are you going to invite them in and then just lecture them? You know, Or are you going to invite them in and ask them questions and invite them to participate? There's a very big difference on how people respond.
So if I might say, see, what you have is a team. So right now you already have a community of people that are interested in the same topic you are. And I think what Matt's saying is you just need to do something. And then other people will join you or ask questions. Do I have
that right? I mean, action is what has an impact on the world. And if you do an action that is visible, it's going to impact everyone that sees it. I mean, that's the whole point of a direct action, of some sort of event or just going into a square at the college campus and just standing literally on a soapbox or anything, saying what you have to say, or creating a play or something and acting that out, or making a song, I mean, anything, making art.
A graffiti. Or something. There's so much you could do just on this campus.
And another part of it is to make sure you're being authentic and you're having fun, and you know, really like putting your heart and trying to trying to bring joy to the journey that you're on, because it's very easy, because you know you're pushing against the ocean here, trying to make change in the world, and so you want to be stirring up fun, positive energy while you're doing it, because there are going to be lots of times where it's really hard. All right, let's see here.
I'll just need maybe 6 minutes at the end.
Yeah, and we're stopped at 3:15. Is that the, or is it?
Yeah, 3:14.
Well, I mean, that's basically, other than like, you know, trying to explain more of how the hive works, that's basically my stuff. I've got, there's a lot of video on the hive site about different aspects of what I'm doing. And let me see, I'll just show you, since it's there, I'll show you one more piece of it. So one thing that I've sort of been using it for is it's kind of like, it's a great way to just organize your own ideas and then be able to instantly attach videos to the ideas. So you can quickly go back and sort of be like, oh, that was interesting, and stick a video next to it. And so, because every time you put a link in, if you put a video in, it becomes more meaningful for you and more informative. And as you keep going with that, let's go this way. So basically each of these ideas sort of builds on the next one. So each video then becomes sort of a thread to the idea. And so it becomes, in a way, a video blog. And so I'm just going to keep going into this because I want to show you. So I've been clicking through ideas, each one that connects, and this is a documentary about the work, basically about me and this, the work I'm doing, sort of stitching these clips together here up to the first words I say in the hospital boardroom, to the, this is one of the first debates. Okay. So now you might not have gotten a full sense of that you just threaded through like 10 videos there. If you were watching, you could, but this little guy here, that little arrow, it actually changes the interface. So this is a much faster interface for cruising through the hive. And what you're looking at now is the thread you just followed of ideas and videos stacked on top of each other. So if you say, if you were researching some activist topic or any topic you're interested in, and you did this, you could basically use this link to be a way to share with someone, or to just for yourself to share, basically a video blog, or even like a mini. I mean, it's almost like creating a little documentary that way. Does that make any sense?
Mm-hmm. Make any sense? So,
And so that's probably the way this is going to go. It's going to be, and to get back to the Hive, the main interface, there's just this little Hive link, and it takes you into back into the main interface. And this is just the beginning. I mean, this is what I was able to build with my level of expertise. But again, and basically what I'm doing is I am trying to, as I share this with people and talk about it, I am looking to build up sort of a development community to help sort of make this, to help improve this and make it really user-friendly. Because right now it's at the very, it might not be the most user-friendly interface at the moment. Okay, so if you want to learn more or just follow what I'm doing or use the software, the Hive One is the place where you can actually use that Hive platform. And again, you just go into the test node and create your own, or just go in and start messing around. You can just answer questions and play with it, and you'll get the hang of it that way. These other websites are the other ways to follow what I'm doing. This is my actual hospital commissioner website, and then I'm on Facebook and Twitter.
Can you, you have that on my desktop right now, uh-huh. And I have a copy of this to modify down a little bit so that they can have some of the information of what you just presented?
Yeah, I mean you can have the whole presentation, do whatever okay. you want with it.
Yeah, and so I'll put this up on Canvas for those of you who like to take a look at these connections.
So that's basically what I got for you today. Do you want them to break into their teams briefly? Well,
they're in their teams now. Okay. What do you have, first of all, some questions for Matt? Ideas that maybe came to you? I asked you to write down at least three. That he could give you some more details about or help answer any questions you might have.
Yeah, hopefully.
I know I've been asking a lot of questions, but I promise I'm saving this one for the whole presentation. You say like this is mindful activism.
Mm.
So when you were first starting the presentation, I'm not trying to step on your toes, I promise.
No, go for it.
When you're talking about like protesting at like Bank America, and making sure that people can't get in. And then I sort of saw that as mindless activism until you started going into about what you did with the hospital and even with the hive mind. Would you agree or disagree with me that your activism improved? Mm. Or do you think that they both were just activism?
That's interesting. So I did say we were blocking the entrance, but we didn't. We did obstruct the entrance, but we did not, I was not comfortable, and some activists totally would block the entrance. And we did not do that, and I was not willing to do that. I was comfortable just obstructing, and then, a few people did sort of go by us. And so I still feel I was being very thoughtful about what I did and what I was willing to do there. But it was definitely, I hope I've improved. I mean, it was definitely a learning experience. And I was, back in Occupy, I was sort of, I wasn't sure about the tactic of going after Bank of America. I wasn't really sure that was the greatest tactic, but everyone thought it was good, and they're like, all right, I'll put my brain and my efforts into this. Because it seems everyone thinks this is a good way to attack corporate power. And so I said, I'll give it a try.
Well, I mean, I applaud you for trying. I don't want to step on your toes, because that's still a good thing in my opinion.
Not stepping on my toes. Yeah.
So that's like who you're trying to reach by like setting up those tents? You're trying to get like recognized by Bank of America, like the higher, like what were you trying to accomplish?
Well, for me it was a, we had just bailed out the banks. It was just sort of like a blatant use of the government and taxpayer money to help private corporations. So it was calling attention to that. And for me, it was basically calling attention to everyone of the
the gross amount of corporate power there is. They were saying, the Chinese banks were too big to fail, and we were basically saying they were too big to exist. They weren't doing us any good. And so it was just trying to get everyone's attention. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, I have another one.
Do you have another one?
So, like, did you guys inform the people that, like, walked by you to go into the bank, or did you just kind of just obstruct?
Oh, no, there were signs. I mean, protest signs are one way to get your basic message out. And we had like, a play, and we had singers, and the dialogue that happens around an activist action is kind of, like, the most important thing that's going on, because that's where you're really stimulating debate and questions. Yes.
I was wondering, like, what's your philosophy for trying to fix the problems, like, at the hierarchy, like, here, like you're talking about?
Yeah, I mean, the Hive platform is my strategy. It's I think we just need to sort of teach each other that the people in the country actually have all the power. We just learn how to actually use it together. And the tactic used to stop us from doing that is to prevent us from uniting and talking about it. And so a tactic, they try to divide us by coming up with issues that will divide us. And even on the, they try to divide the left wing and the right wing to keep them from uniting and really just seeing, all we have to decide is what we want. Because once enough people, even in a state, just say we want this, it becomes really, really hard for the state legislators to say no. You know, if we have everyone in the state saying we want state-based single-payer health care or, you know, whatever, it's really, really hard to just ignore that once it's clearly stated by the people. It becomes very transparent. The corruption becomes very transparent. And there's another question back there.
So our project is on the mentally ill homeless, and basically what our idea was to raise awareness for our politicians that, like, millennials are, like, concerned with this issue, basically. So, like, off the top of your head, what would be, like, a good first step for us to do in order to do that?
So the mentally ill and homeless?
Specifically the homeless people that are mentally ill.
And your tactic is to get the politicians to care about it. That's what you're trying to get them to?
Well, to show them that there's public interest in that social.
It's good to sort of have a specific, like, action that you want the politician to do. That you can really sort of, like, pressure them with that. So if you have some idea of, like, if there's a facility that needs to be expanded, or if you find there's an innovative program somewhere in the country that's doing something really great for the mentally ill and homeless, you can say, why don't you do that? Why don't you replicate what was done in this area? Or if you just come up with your own idea, like, we need more outpatient mental health services, or we need more inpatient mental health services. And you might want to talk to people that are like really, really engaged in that issue, because they'll have, often if you find someone that's engaged in it, they'll have ideas. They'll be like, this is what we need. And they'd love to see some people, you know, go and fight and pressure for these solutions that they've come up with. Yeah?
All right, so in your early days of networking, how much networking did you do on social media?
In my early days of networking, you mean for, like, I mean, I've been on the internet since the internet explosion, so I have like a lot of history on the internet. Okay. But in the early days it was socializing. It's part of my political and activist work. I don't know what you're getting at for that question.
I was just asking, like, how much did you do it, and, like, how it affected what you were trying to reach people to?
You know, actually, I find networking online to be the worst kind of networking. Best kind is going to a meeting. Like, just find people that are doing something related to what you want to network about and go in person. It's just like, when you're in person with someone,
it is so much more powerful than online. And so what it, but what it does, it feeds your online presence. If you go to a meetup for something, and you talk, you know, you speak up and you say, hey, I'm doing this, or I'm trying to raise awareness on this mental health, you know, homeless person issue, and you say it, you'll go home and you'll have like 10 people just followed you on Twitter from that meetup. It's like, it's, and it's, they've seen you and they know you. When I went to the Occupy National Gatherings, it was crazy, you know, because I was meeting all these people, and suddenly my phone was blowing up while I'm at the National Gathering from people I'm meeting there. They're immediately following me on their phones, and it was the most successful online networking I ever did because I was in person actually meeting real people. Yeah?
I just wanted to add on to that, like, really good thing has, like, cars. Like, because I have cars, and, like, I need to, like, network really fast because I can just give people information. I was wondering, like, do you use cards?
I do, and I have a bunch of cards here, so I don't have enough for everyone, but I'll put some out, and anyone that wants one can have one. It has my contact info on it. And really, you guys are welcome to contact me if you ever want to feedback on anything related to activism or meditation, really. And so that offer's out there until, like, I become famous and I get too many contacts like that. Then I'll have to change that. But then I'll use the Hive. I'll still have that Ask Me Anything, so you can just ask a question there if suddenly there's thousands of people. Who else? You had a question.
You talked a lot about how, like, being, like, a politician and trying to change things was a lot about, like, carefully picking your tactics. Like, currently a large issue is, like, the Senate, like, blocking the selection of the new Supreme Court justice. And even though one of your, like, important tactics was, like, making it transparent, it's, like, the public, like, everyone knows, and it's very obvious what they're doing, and nothing's being done.